Welcome back to Law Requisites PH, where we discuss relevant Philippine laws and regulations to help inform Filipinos about their basic rights. Know your rights, as it might one day save your life. In the last videos, we talked about Rule 1 to 39. Today, we will talk about the revised civil procedure on Rule 40 to Rule 44. Want to receive updates from us? Subscribe now. Appeals Rule 40, appeal from municipal trial courts to the regional trial court, Section 1. Where to appeal? An appeal from a judgment or final order of a municipal trial court may be taken to the regional trial court exercising jurisdiction over the area to which the former pertains. The title of the case shall remain as it was in the court of origin, but the party appealing the case shall be further referred to as the appellant and the adverse party as the appellee. N. Section 2. When to appeal. An appeal may be taken within 15 days after notice to the appellant of the judgment or final order appealed from. Where a record on appeal is required, the appellant shall file a notice of appeal and a record on appeal within 30 days after notice of the judgment or final order. The period of appeal shall be interrupted by a timely motion for new trial or reconsideration. No motion for extension of time to file a motion for new trial or reconsideration shall be allowed. N. Section 3. How to appeal. The appeal is taken by filing a notice of appeal with the court that rendered the judgment or final order appealed from. The notice of appeal shall indicate the parties to the appeal, the judgment or final order or part thereof appealed from, and state the material dates showing the timeliness of the appeal. A record on appeal shall be required only in special proceedings and in other cases of multiple or separate appeals. The form and contents of the record on appeal shall be as provided in Section 6, Rule 41. Copies of the notice of appeal and the record on appeal, where required, shall be served on the adverse party. N. Section 4. Perfection of appeal. Effect thereof. The perfection of the appeal and the effect thereof shall be governed by the provisions of Section 9, Rule 41. N. Section 5. Appellate court docket and other lawful fees. Within the period for taking an appeal, the appellant shall pay to the clerk of the court which rendered the judgment or final order appealed from the full amount of the appellate court docket and other lawful fees. Proof of payment thereof shall be transmitted to the appellate court together with the original record or the record on appeal, as the case may be. N. Section 6. Duty of the clerk of court. Within 15 days from the perfection of the appeal, the clerk of court or the branch clerk of court of the lower court shall transmit the original record or the record on appeal, together with the transcripts and exhibits, which he shall certify as complete, to the proper regional trial court. A copy of his letter of transmittal of the records to the appellate court shall be furnished the parties. N. Rules 40-41, Section 7. Procedure in the regional trial court. A. Upon receipt of the complete record or the record on appeal, the clerk of court of the regional trial court shall notify the parties of such fact. B. Within 15 days from such notice, it shall be the duty of the appellant to submit a memorandum which shall briefly discuss the errors imputed to the lower court, a copy of which shall be furnished by him to the adverse party. Within 15 days from receipt of the appellant memorandum, the appellee may file his memorandum. Failure of the appellant to file a memorandum shall be a ground for dismissal of the appeal. C. Upon the filing of the memorandum of the appellee or the expiration of the period to do so, the case shall be considered submitted for decision. The regional trial court shall decide the case on the basis of the entire record of the proceedings had in the court of origin and such memoranda as are filed. N. Section 8. Appeal from orders dismissing case without trial. Lack of jurisdiction. If an appeal is taken from an order of the lower court dismissing the case without a trial on the merits, the regional trial court may affirm or reverse it, as the case may be. In case of affirmance and the ground of dismissal is lack of jurisdiction over the subject matter, the regional trial court, if it has jurisdiction thereover, shall try the case on the merits as if the case was originally filed with it. In case of reversal, the case shall be remanded for further proceedings. If the case was tried on the merits by the lower court without jurisdiction over the subject matter, the regional trial court on appeal shall not dismiss the case if it has original jurisdiction thereof, but shall decide the case in accordance with the preceding section, without prejudice to the admission of amended pleadings and additional evidence in the interest of justice. N. Section 9. Applicability of Rule 41. The other provisions of Rule 41 shall apply to appeals provided for herein insofar as they are not inconsistent with or may serve to supplement the provisions of this rule. N. Rule 41 Appeal from the Regional Trial Court Section 1. Subject of Appeal. An appeal may be taken from a judgment or final order that completely disposes of the case, or of a particular matter therein when declared by these rules to be appealable. No appeal may be taken from, a, an order denying a petition for relief or any similar motion seeking relief from judgment, b, an interlocutory order, c, an order disallowing or dismissing an appeal, d, an order denying a motion to set aside a judgment by consent, confession or compromise on the ground of fraud, mistake or duress, or any other ground vitiating consent, e, an order of execution, f, a judgment or final order for or against one or more of several parties or in separate claims, counterclaims, cross-claims and third-party complaints, while the main case is pending, unless the court allows an appeal therefrom. And g, an order dismissing an action without prejudice. In any of the foregoing circumstances, the aggrieved party may file an appropriate special civil action as provided in Rule 65. As amended by A.M. Number 07-7-12 SC, December 1, 2007. Section 2. Modes of Appeal. A. Ordinary Appeal. The appeal to the Court of Appeals in cases decided by the Regional Trial Court in the exercise of its original jurisdiction shall be taken by filing a notice of appeal with the court which rendered the judgment or final order appealed from and serving a copy thereof upon the averse party. No record on appeal shall be required except in special proceedings and other cases of multiple or separate appeals where the law or these rules so require. In such cases, the record on appeal shall be filed and served in like manner. B. Petition for Review. The appeal to the Court of Appeals in cases decided by the Regional Trial Court in the exercise of its appellate jurisdiction shall be by petition for review in accordance with Rule 42. C. Appeal by certiorari. In all cases where only questions of law are raised or involved, the appeal shall be to the Supreme Court by petition for review on certiorari in accordance with Rule 45. N. Section 3. Period of Ordinary Appeal. Appeal in habeas corpus cases. The appeal shall be taken within 15 days from notice of the judgment or final order appealed from. Where a record on appeal is required, the appellants shall file a notice of appeal and a record on appeal within 30 days from notice of the judgment or final order. However, on appeal in habeas corpus cases shall be taken within 48 hours from notice of the judgment or final order appealed from. A.M. Number 01-1-03 SC, June 19, 2001. The period of appeal shall be interrupted by a timely motion for new trial or reconsideration. No motion for extension of time to file a motion for new trial or reconsideration shall be allowed. N. Section 4. Appellate court docket and other lawful fees. Within the period for taking an appeal, the appellant shall pay to the clerk of the court which rendered the judgment or final order appealed from, the full amount of the appellate court docket and other lawful fees. Proof of payment of said fees shall be transmitted to the appellate court together with the original record or the record on appeal. N. Section 5. Notice of Appeal. The notice of appeal shall indicate the parties to the appeal, specify the judgment or final order or part thereof appealed from, specify the court to which the appeal is being taken, and state the material dates showing the timeliness of the appeal. 4A, Section 6. Record on Appeal. Form and contents thereof. The full names of all the parties to the proceedings shall be stated in the caption of the record on appeal, and it shall include the judgment or final order from which the appeal is taken and, in chronological order, copies of only such pleadings, petitions, motions and all interlocutory orders as are related to the appeal judgment or final order for the proper understanding of the issue involved, together with such data as will show that the appeal was perfected on time. If an issue of fact is to be raised on appeal, the record on appeal shall include by reference all the evidence, testimonial and documentary, taken upon the issue involved. The reference shall specify the documentary evidence by the exhibit numbers or letters by which it was identified when admitted or offered at the hearing, and the testimonial evidence by the names of the corresponding witnesses. If the whole testimonial and documentary evidence in the case is to be included, a statement to that effect will be sufficient without mentioning the names of the witnesses or the numbers or letters of exhibits. Every record on appeal exceeding 2020 pages must contain a subject index. 6A, Section 7. Approval of Record on Appeal. Upon the filing of the record on appeal for approval and if no objection is filed by the appellee within 5 days from receipt of a copy thereof, the trial court may approve it as presented or upon its own motion or at the instance of the appellee, may direct its amendment by the inclusion of any omitted matters which are deemed essential to the determination of the issue of law or fact involved in the appeal. If the trial court orders the amendment of the record, the appellant, within the time limited in the order, or such extension thereof as may be granted, or if no time is fixed by the order within 10 days from receipt thereof, shall redraft the record by including therein, in their proper chronological sequence, such additional matters as the court may have directed him to incorporate, and shall thereupon submit the redrafted record for approval, upon notice to the appellee, in like manner as the original draft. 7A, Section 8. Joint Record on Appeal. Where both parties are appellants, they may file a joint record on appeal within the time fixed by Section 3 of this rule, or that fixed by the court. 8A, Section 9. Perfection of Appeal. Effect thereof. A party appealed by notice of appeal is deemed perfected as to and upon the filing of the notice of appeal in due time. A party appealed by record on appeal is deemed perfected as to him with respect to the subject matter thereof upon the approval of the record on appeal filed in due time. In appeals by notice of appeal, the court loses jurisdiction over the case upon the perfection of the appeals filed in due time and the expiration of the time to appeal of the other parties. In appeals by record on appeal, the court loses jurisdiction only over the subject matter thereof upon the approval of the records on appeal filed in due time and the expiration of the time to appeal of the other parties. In either case, prior to the transmittal of the original record or the record on appeal, the court may issue orders for the protection and preservation of the rights of the parties which do not involve any matter litigated by the appeal, approve compromises, permit appeals of indigent litigants, order execution pending appeal in accordance with Section 2 of Rule 39, and allow withdrawal of the appeal. 9A, Section 10. Duty of Clerk of Court of the Lower Court upon perfection of appeal. Within 30 days after perfection of all the appeals in accordance with the preceding section, it shall be the duty of the Clerk of Court of the Lower Court, A, to verify the correctness of the original record or the record on appeal, as the case may be, and to make a certification of its correctness. B, to verify the completeness of the records that will be transmitted to the appellate court. C, if found to be incomplete, to take such measures as may be required to complete the records, availing of the authority that he or the court may exercise for this purpose. And D, to transmit the records to the appellate court. If the efforts to complete the records fail, he shall indicate in his letter of transmittal the exhibits or transcripts not included in the records being transmitted to the appellate court, the reasons for their non-transmittal, and the steps taken or that could be taken to have them available. The clerk of court shall furnish the parties with copies of his letter of transmittal of the records to the appellate court. 10a, Section 11. Transcript. Upon the perfection of the appeal, the clerk shall immediately direct the stenographers concerned to attach to the record of the case 5-5, copies of the transcripts of the testimonial evidence referred to in the record on appeal. The stenographers concerned shall transcribe such testimonial evidence and shall prepare an affix to their transcripts an index containing the names of the witnesses and the pages wherein their testimonies are found, and a list of the exhibits and the pages wherein each of them appears to have been offered and admitted or rejected by the trial court. The transcripts shall be transmitted to the clerk of the trial court, who shall thereupon arrange the same in the order in which the witnesses testified at the trial, and shall cause the pages to be numbered consecutively. 12a, Section 12, Transmittal. The clerk of the trial court shall transmit to the appellate court the original record or the approved record on appeal within 30 days from the perfection of the appeal, together with a proof of payment of the appellate court docket and other lawful fees, a certified true copy of the minutes of the proceedings, the order of approval, the certificate of correctness, the original documentary evidence referred to therein, and the original and 3-3 copies of the transcripts. Copies of the transcripts and certified true copies of the documentary evidence shall remain in the lower court for the examination of the parties. 11a, Section 13. Dismissal of appeal. Prior to the transmittal of the original record or the record on appeal to the appellate court, the trial court may, motu proprio or on motion, dismiss the appeal for having been taken out of time or for non-payment of the docket and other lawful fees within the reglementary period. As amended by A.M. No. 00-2-10 S.C., May 1, 2000. Rule 42. Petition for review from the regional trial courts to the Court of Appeals. Section 1. How appeal taken. Time for filing. A party desiring to appeal from a decision of the regional trial court rendered in the exercise of its appellate jurisdiction may file a verified petition for review with the Court of Appeals, paying at the same time to the clerk of said court the corresponding docket and other lawful fees, depositing the amount of P500.00 for costs, and furnishing the regional trial court and the adverse party with a copy of the petition. The petition shall be filed and served within 15 days from notice of the decision sought to be reviewed or of the denial of petition or motion for new trial or reconsideration filed in due time after judgment. Upon proper motion and the payment of the full amount of the docket and other lawful fees and the deposit for costs before the expiration of the reglementary period, the Court of Appeals may grant an additional period of 15 days only within which to file the petition for review. No further extension shall be granted except for the most compelling reason and in no case to exceed 15 days. N. Section 2. Form and Contents. The petition shall be filed in 7-7, legible copies, with the original copy intended for the court being indicated as such by the petitioner, and shall a. state the full names of the parties to the case, without impleading the lower courts or judges thereof either as petitioners or respondents. B. Indicate the specific material dates showing that it was filed on time. C. Set forth concisely a statement of the matters involved, the issues raised, the specification of errors of fact or law, or both, allegedly committed by the regional trial court, and the reasons or arguments relied upon for the allowance of the appeal. D. Be accompanied by clearly legible duplicate originals or true copies of the judgments or final orders of both lower courts, certified correct by the clerk of court of the regional trial court, the requisite number of plain copies thereof and of the pleadings and other material portions of the record as would support the allegations of the petition. The petitioner shall also submit together with the petition a certification under oath that he has not theretofore commenced any other action involving the same issues in the Supreme Court, the Court of Appeals or different divisions thereof, or any other tribunal or agency. If there is such other action or proceeding, he must state the status of the same. And if he should thereafter learn that a similar action or proceeding has been filed or is pending before the Supreme Court, the Court of Appeals, or different divisions thereof, or any other tribunal or agency, he undertakes to promptly inform the aforesaid courts and other tribunal or agency thereof within 5 days therefrom. N. Section 3. Effect of failure to comply with requirements. The failure of the petitioner to comply with any of the foregoing requirements regarding the payment of the docket and other lawful fees, the deposit for costs, proof of service of the petition, and the contents of and the documents which should accompany the petition shall be sufficient ground for the dismissal thereof. N. Section 4. Action on the petition. The Court of Appeals may require the respondent to file a comment on the petition, not a motion to dismiss, within 10 days from notice, or dismiss the petition if it finds the same to be patently without merit, prosecuted manifestly for delay, or that the questions raised therein are too unsubstantial to require consideration. N. Section 5. Contents of comment. The comment of the respondent shall be filed in 7 legible copies, accompanied by certified true copies of such material portions of the record referred to therein together with other supporting papers, and shall a state whether or not he accepts the statement of matters involved in the petition. B. Point out such insufficiencies or inaccuracies as he believes exist in petitioner's statement of matters involved but without repetition. And C. State the reasons why the petition should not be given due course. A copy thereof shall be served on the petitioner. N. Section 6. Due course. If upon the filing of the comment or such other pleadings as the court may allow or require, or after the expiration of the period for the filing thereof without such comment or pleading having been submitted, the Court of Appeals finds prima facie that the lower court has committed an error fact or law that will warrant a reversal or modification of the appeal decision, it may accordingly give due course to the petition. N. Section 7. Elevation of record. Whenever the Court of Appeals deems it necessary, it may order the clerk of court of the regional trial court to elevate the original record of the case, including the oral and documentary evidence, within 15 days from notice. N. Section 8. Perfection of appeal. Effect thereof. A. Upon the timely filing of a petition for review and the payment of the corresponding docket and other lawful fees, the appeal is deemed perfected as to the petitioner. The regional trial court loses jurisdiction over the case upon the perfection of the appeals filed in due time and the expiration of the time to appeal of the other parties. However, before the Court of Appeals gives due course to the petition, the regional trial court may issue orders for the protection and preservation of the rights of the parties which do not involve any matter litigated by the appeal, approve compromises, permit appeals of indigent litigants, order execution pending appeal in accordance with Section 2 of Rule 39, and allow withdrawal of the appeal. 9a, R. 41, b. Except in civil cases decided under the rule on summary procedure, the appeal shall stay the judgment or final order unless the Court of Appeals, the law, or these rules shall provide otherwise. N. Section 9. Submission for decision. If the petition is given due course, the Court of Appeals may set the case for oral argument or require the parties to submit memoranda within a period of 15 days from notice. The case shall be deemed submitted for decision upon the filing of the last pleading or memorandum required by these rules or by the court itself. N. Rule 43. Appeals from the Court of Tax Appeals and Quasi-Judicial Agencies to the Court of Appeals. Section 1. Scope. This rule shall apply to appeals from judgments or final orders of the Court of Tax Appeals and from awards, judgments, final orders or resolutions of or authorized by any quasi-judicial agency in the exercise of its quasi-judicial functions. Among these agencies are the Civil Service Commission, Central Board of Assessment Appeals, Securities and Exchange Commission, Office of the President, Land Registration Authority, Social Security Commission, Civil Aeronautics Board, Bureau of Patents, Trademarks and Technology Transfer, National Electrification Administration, Energy Regulatory Board, National Telecommunications Commission, Department of Agrarian Reform under Republic Act No. 6657, Government Service Insurance System, Employees' Compensation Commission, Agricultural Inventions Board, Insurance Commission, Philippine Atomic Energy Commission, Board of Investments, Construction Industry Arbitration Commission, and voluntary arbitrators authorized by law. N. Section 2. Cases not covered. This rule shall not apply to judgments or final orders issued under the Labor Code of Philippines. N. Section 3. Where to appeal. An appeal under this rule may be taken to the Court of Appeals within the period and in the manner herein provided, whether the appeal involves questions of fact, of law, or mixed questions of fact and law. N. Section 4. Period of Appeal. The appeal shall be taken within 15 days from notice of the award, judgment, final order or resolution, or from the date of its last publication, if publication is required by law for its effectivity, or of the denial of petition or motion for new trial or reconsideration duly filed in accordance with the governing law of the court or agency a quo. Only 1-1, motion for reconsideration shall be allowed. Upon proper motion and the payment of the full amount of the docket fee before the expiration of the reglementary period, the Court of Appeals may grant an additional period of 15 days only within which to file the petition for review. No further extension shall be granted except for the most compelling reason and in no case to exceed 15 days. N. Section 5. How appeal taken. Appeal shall be taken by filing a verified petition for review in 7-7, legible copies with the Court of Appeals, with proof of service of a copy thereof on the averse party and on the court or agency a quo. The original copy of the petition intended for the Court of Appeals shall be indicated as such by the petitioner. Upon the filing of the petitioner shall pay to the clerk of court of the Court of Appeals the docketing and other lawful fees and deposit the sum of P500.00 for costs. Exemption from payment of docketing and other lawful fees and the deposit for costs may be granted by the Court of Appeals upon a verified motion setting forth valid grounds therefore. If the Court of Appeals denies the motion, the petitioner shall pay the docketing and other lawful fees and deposit for costs within 15 days from notice of the denial. N. Section 6. Contents of the petition. The petition for review shall A. state the full names of the parties to the case, without impleting the court or agencies either as petitioners or respondents. B. Contain a concise statement of the facts and issues involved and the grounds relied upon for the review. C. Be accompanied by a clearly legible duplicate original or a certified true copy of the award, judgment, final order or resolution appealed from, together with certified true copies of such material portions of the record referred to therein and other supporting papers. And D. Contain a sworn certification against forum shopping as provided in the last paragraph of Section 2, Rule 42. The petition shall state the specific material dates showing that it was filed within the period fixed herein. 2A, Section 7. Effect of failure to comply with requirements. The failure of the petitioner to comply with any of the foregoing requirements regarding the payment of the docket and other lawful fees, the deposit for costs, proof of service of the petition, and the contents of and the documents which should accompany the petition shall be sufficient ground for the dismissal thereof. N. Section 8. Action on the petition. The Court of Appeals may require the respondent to file a comment on the petition, not a motion to dismiss, within 10 days from notice, or dismiss the petition if it finds the same to be patently without merit, prosecuted manifestly for delay, or that the questions raised therein are too unsubstantial to require consideration. 6A, Section 9. Contents of comment. The comment shall be filed within 10 days from notice in 7-7, legible copies and accompanied by clearly legible certified true copies of such material portions of the record referred to therein together with other supporting papers. The comment shall a. point out insufficiencies or inaccuracies in petitioner's statement of facts and issues. And b. state the reasons why the petition should be denied or dismissed. A copy thereof shall be served on the petitioner, and proof of such service shall be filed with the Court of Appeals. 9a, Section 10. Due course. If upon the filing of the comment or such other pleadings or documents as may be required or allowed by the Court of Appeals or upon the expiration of the period for the filing thereof, and on the basis of the petition or the records the Court of Appeals finds prima facie that the court or agency concerned has committed errors of fact or law that would warrant reversal or modification of the award, judgment, final order or resolution sought to be reviewed, it may give due course to the petition. Otherwise, it shall dismiss the same. The findings of fact of the court or agency concerned, when supported by substantial evidence, shall be binding on the Court of Appeals. N. Section 11. Transmittal of record. Within 15 days from notice that the petition has been given due course, the Court of Appeals may require the court or agency concerned to transmit the original or illegible certified true copy of the entire record of the proceeding under review. The record to be transmitted may be abridged by agreement of all parties to the proceeding. The Court of Appeals may require or permit subsequent correction of or addition to the record. 8a, Section 12. Effect of appeal. The appeal shall not stay the award, judgment, final order or resolution sought to be reviewed unless the Court of Appeals shall direct otherwise upon such terms as it may deem just. 10a, Section 13. Submission for decision. If the petition is given due course, the Court of Appeals may set the case for oral argument or require the parties to submit memoranda within a period of 15 days from notice. The case shall be deemed submitted for decision upon the filing of the last pleading or memorandum required by these rules or by the Court of Appeals. N. Procedure in the Court of Appeals Rule 44 Ordinary Appealed Cases Section 1. Title of Cases. In all cases appealed to the Court of Appeals under Rule 41, the title of the case shall remain as it was in the court of origin, but the party appealing the case shall be further referred to as the appellant and the adverse party as the appellee. 1a, R. 46, Section 2. Counsel and Guardians. The counsel and guardians ad litem of the parties in the court of origin shall be respectively considered as their counsel and guardians ad litem in the Court of Appeals. When others appear or are appointed, notice thereof shall be served immediately on the adverse party and filed with the court. 2a, R. 46, Section 3. Order of transmittal of record. If the original record or the record on appeal is not transmitted to the Court of Appeals within 30 days after the perfection of the appeal, either party may file a motion with the trial court, with notice to the other, for the transmittal of such record or record on appeal. 3a, R. 46, Section 4. Docketing of case. Upon receiving the original record or the record on appeal and the accompanying documents and exhibits transmitted by the lower court, as well as the proof of payment of the docket and other lawful fees, the clerk of court of the Court of Appeals shall docket the case and notify the parties thereof. 4a, R. 46, within 10 days from receipt of said notice, the appellant, in appeals by record on appeal, shall file with the clerk of court 7 clearly legible copies of the approved record on appeal, together with the proof of service of 2 copies thereof upon the appellee. Any unauthorized alteration, omission or addition in the approved record on appeal shall be a ground for dismissal of the appeal. N. Section 5. Completion of record. Where the record of the docketed case is incomplete, the clerk of the Court of Appeals shall so inform said court and recommend to it measures necessary to complete the record. It shall be the duty of said court to take appropriate action towards the completion of the record within the shortest possible time. N. Section 6. Dispensing with complete record. Where the completion of the record could not be accomplished within a sufficient period allotted for said purpose due to insuperable or extremely difficult causes, the court, on its own motion or on motion of any of the parties, may declare that the record and its accompanying transcripts and exhibits so far available are sufficient to decide the issues raised in the appeal, and shall issue an order explaining the reasons for such declaration. N. Section 7. Appellant Brief. It shall be the duty of the appellant to file with the court, within 45 days from receipt of the notice of the clerk that all the evidence, oral and documentary, are attached to the record, 7-7, copies of his legibly typewritten, mimeographed or printed brief, with proof of service of 2-2, copies thereof upon the appellee. 10a, R. 46, Section 8. Appellee Brief. Within 45 days from receipt of the appellant brief, the appellee shall file with the court 7-7, copies of his legibly typewritten, mimeographed or printed brief, with proof of service of 2-2, copies thereof upon the appellant. 11a, R. 46, Section 9. Appellant Reply Brief. Within 20 days from receipt of the appellee brief, the appellant may file a reply brief answering points in the appellee brief not covered in his main brief. 12, R. 46, Section 10. Time for filing memoranda in special cases. Certiorari, prohibition, mandamus, quo warranto and habeas corpus cases, the parties shall file, in lieu of briefs, their respective memoranda within a non-extendable period of 30 days from receipt of the notice issued by the clerk that all the evidence, oral and documentary, is already attached to the record. 13a, R. 46, the failure of the appellant to file his memorandum within the period therefore may be a ground for dismissal of the appeal. N. Section 11. Several appellants or appellees or several counsel for each party. Where there are several appellants or appellees, each counsel representing one or more but not all of them shall be served with only one copy of the briefs. When several counsel represent one appellant or appellee, copies of the brief may be served upon any of them. 14a, R. 46, Section 12. Extension of time for filing briefs. Extension of time for the filing of briefs will not be allowed, except for good and sufficient cause, and only if the motion for extension is filed before the expiration of the time sought to be extended. 15, R. 46, Section 13. Contents of appellant brief. The appellant brief shall contain, in the order herein indicated, the following: a subject index of the matter in the brief with a digest of the arguments and page references, and a table of cases alphabetically arranged, textbooks and statutes cited with references to the pages where they are cited. B. An assignment of errors intended to be urged, which error shall be separately, distinctly and concisely stated without repetition and numbered consecutively. C. Under the heading statement of the case, a clear and concise statement of the nature of the action, a summary of the proceedings, the appealed rulings and orders of the court, the nature of the judgment and any other matters necessary to an understanding of the nature of the controversy, with page references to the record. D. Under the heading statement of facts, a clear and concise statement in a narrative form of the facts admitted by both parties and of those in controversy, together with the substance of the proof relating thereto in sufficient detail to make it clearly intelligible, with page references to the record. E. A clear and concise statement of the issues of fact or law to be submitted to the court for its judgment. F. Under the heading argument, the appellant arguments on each assignment of error with page references to the record. The authorities relied upon shall be cited by the page of the report at which the case begins and the page of the report on which the citation is found. G. Under the heading Alif, a specification of the order or judgment which the appellant seeks. And H. In cases not brought up by record on appeal, the appellant brief shall contain, as an appendix, a copy of the judgment or final order appealed from. 16a, R. 46, Section 14. Contents of appellee brief. The appellee brief shall contain, in the order herein indicated, the following: a. a subject index of the matter in the brief with a digest of the arguments and page references, and a table of cases alphabetically arranged, textbooks and statutes cited with references to the pages where they are cited. B. Under the heading Statement of Facts, the appellee shall state that he accepts the statement of facts in the appellant brief, or under the heading Outer Statement of Facts, he shall point out such insufficiencies or inaccuracies as he believes exist in the appellant statement of facts with references to the pages of the record in support thereof, but without repetition of matters in the appellant statement of facts. And C. Under the heading Argument, the appellee shall set forth his arguments in the case on each assignment of error with page references to the record. The authorities relied on shall be cited by the page of the report at which the case begins and the page of the report on which the citation is found. 17a, R. 46, Section 15. Questions that may be raised on appeal. Whether or not the appellant has filed a motion for new trial court below, he may include in his assignment of errors any question of law or fact that has been raised in the court below and which is within the issues framed by the parties. 18, R. 46. End of segment. Like, share and subscribe to this YouTube channel to continue watching
Welcome
this content.
Welcome back to Law Requisites CR playlist
where we
discuss
relevant Philippine laws and regulations to
help
you next time.
Filipinos
about their